This evening I have with me Cllr. McCarthy. You've been writing a column for the last 10 years on the history of Cork. It's good to have you here.
Yeah, no, thanks very much for the invitation, John.
When I walk through the city of Cork, it seems to me that the city itself tells a story.
I'm a geographer by trade, so I have a huge interest in landscapes and how you can read a landscape and how you actually understand a landscape. And to me, I suppose in my own head, a landscape is more than just a view. A landscape has a voice. So when you kind of walk around Cork and you look at all the buildings, I always think that they actually have a voice. And when you add in, if you do kind of oral histories and you talk to the people, they also have a voice.
Well, that's true. The first voice that people talk about when they think of Cork is Finbarr. Who was Finbarr?
Finbarr is the patron saint of Cork. He was educated as a monk in Kilkenny. In his late teens, he began to set up his own monasteries. One of his most famous monasteries was in the middle of the Shehi Mountains, or more affectionately known as Gugan Barra, and then actually walked the River Lee from about a 45-mile walk from what's now the Shehi Mountains, Gugan Barra, as far as Cork, to establish a monastery that's now marked by St. Finbarr's Cathedral. He's left an enormous legacy. I've spent the last 4 years writing a column in the paper called On the Steps of St. Finbarr, tracking this saint down the River Lee Valley. He's remembered in every church in the River Lee Valley. And he's kind of bound up with the early Christian legacy. That's very, very important. It's a city of spires. There's many, many churches from different faiths, and that's important. If you ever kind of go up high or go up on top of Shandon and look down, you'll see all these marvellous spires and marvellous architecture.
In 1985, we celebrated 800 years of the history of Cork. So what happened in 1185?
One of the major landmarks in the city that was developed for that event was actually Bishop Lucy Park. And within Bishop Lucy Park was put a fountain with 8 swans put on it. And each swan represents 100 years since the granting of a charter. Now a charter is a kind of a bill of rights. You can do this and you can't do that. And it's linked into the arrival of the Anglo-Normans into, I suppose, what was known as Kirkuk Mór na Mún, the Great Marsh of Munster. And we know when the Anglo-Normans came in from 1169 onwards into Ireland, they built a walled town. This charter was granted by King Henry II, I suppose the head of the Anglo-Normans within England, and the staging point of the attack actually was from Bristol. So with the charter, Cork was going to have an official marketplace, it was going to have a mayor, it was going to have a corporation of Cork or city councillors. That system is still in place. Bristol's coat of arms is a tower and a ship, and our coat of arms is two towers and a ship. My own theory is that our coat of arms is based on Bristol's coat of arms, and of course Cork's coat of arms is Statio Bene Fide Carinus, which means a safe harbour for ships, that once your ship was docked inside, I suppose, the walled town of Cork, your ship was deemed safe.
There is what seems to me to be an upended cannon on the corner of Tucky Street and the Grand Parade.
To commemorate the siege of Cork, yes, we have a cannon stuck in the ground in the corner of Tucky Street and the Grand Parade. We also have a cannonball that's actually hanging in St. Finbarr's Cathedral. It's also from the siege. But this siege actually lasted 4 days. And basically the background to the siege is that in 1684, a Catholic king came to the throne in England, King James II. His parliament were not happy, I suppose, with a Catholic king, and King James II was forced to go on the run in Ireland. But meanwhile in England, a new king was instated, King William of Orange. He was a Dutch prince. James II and King William went to war. On the 25th of September 1690, Williamite forces planted cannons on the top of the ridges overlooking the walled town of Cork, and the go-ahead was given to fire at the walls of the town to get the supporters of James II to surrender. And the siege ended 4 days later.
Patrick Street, it's a very unusual, very, very distinctive street architecturally, because I notice on one side of the street it seems to be 1930s, and on the other side of the street, Victorian.
At one time, there would have been buildings that kind of dated the 1800s on both sides of Patrick Street. But in December 1920, an attack by the Black and Tans went into the city centre in December 1920 and lit fires at the kind of the southern end of Patrick Street, and the fire spread, and half of Patrick Street was actually burnt down. So, late 1920s in particular, early 1930s, you've got new kind of buildings erected, like what we see today, like Brown Thomas and kind of Penny's buildings, very elaborate kind of Art Deco. So you do have this kind of mixture, 1800s versus kind of 1920s on both sides of the street, which is great to have a look at.
Kieran, thanks again for coming in. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Well, thanks very much for the invite, John.
Pleasure.